Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The subject is Hajj. And a lot of the Muslims, when they speak about Hajj, a lot of the speakers, they normally approach the subject from two angles. The first one, Ruknul Hajj, the Hajj being a pillar of Islam, and the virtues of going to Hajj, the definition of Hajj. That's one way, Rukniyat al-Hajj. The second angle is detailing the rituals. And this is mandatory upon everyone who is actually going to Hajj. Because Hajj is a conditional pillar. كما ورد, as it is mentioned في القرآن, ولله على الناس حج البيت لمن استطاع إليه سبيلا. It is mandatory upon mankind, the translation should be Muslims, to go and perform Hajj if they are able to. وحديث عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله عنهما في الصحيحين, الحديث which you all memorize, بني الإسلام على خمس, Islam is built upon five pillars, وذكر, and he mentioned, وحج البيت لمن استطاع إلى ذلك سبيلا. And the Hajj, if you're able to. Normally any speaker talking about the rituals, if the people are going, then inshallah we talk about the pillars, the duties, what would make your Hajj valid and hopefully accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But there is one angle of Hajj that no one ever mentions normally, إلا من رحم ربي. And this is قصة الحج, the story of Hajj. Behind all these rituals which we perform, each one of them there is a story. If you explore the story of the family of Ibrahim alayhi salam, the story of Hajj is the story of the family of Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this is what I'm intending to share with you tonight, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, if Allah permits. Unless if all of you are going to Hajj, then I will shift and talk about the pillars of Hajj, inshallah, and the duties of Hajj, all of you are going to Hajj, inshallah? Huh? Who is going to Hajj this year? Inshallah you're going? MashaAllah, MashaAllah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from you. May Allah accept from you, Rabbil Alameen. طيب, inshallah, yani, 2 out of 10, that would make it what? Can we do the story of Hajj, or you want to go over the rituals? The story of Hajj is important too. Huh? Why don't we come together? How come you scattered in the masjid? Can I ask you kindly to come? Unless if you want, like Abu Mujahid, I know you need to sit there. You're good. But can we come closer a little bit? I promise I won't bite you. I promise I won't bite you. It's a story time, you know, that's a story time. Where Ibrahim alayhi salam was born? He was born in a country that is filled with fitna right now, Iraq. He was born in Iraq. And subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordained upon him to be born to a father who actually used to manufacture idols for the community. The people used to worship idols. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about Ibrahim alayhi salam, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا إِبْرَاهِيمَ رُشْدَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ. Subhanallah, we read in the Israelites that his father used to give him, and I mean by Israelites, we do not believe it, we do not belie it. It's something there that we can narrate with no chain, as long as it doesn't spoil our religion, it doesn't contradict our deen, we could narrate it. لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, because the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم says, حدثوا عن بني إسرائيل, يعني talk about the previous nations in general. That he used to stand in the market and holding the idol like this, and he would say, who want to buy an idol, a god, who doesn't benefit nor harm, who doesn't speak nor hear? This is how, and his father used to rebuke him for doing that. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala given Nabiullah Ibrahim at early age that understanding, that whatever his qawm, his people, including his own father, is not right. They are worshipping idols beside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he started to challenge them. He started to speak bad about these idols in the open. When they found these idols broken at one stage, and when they wanted to find out who did this, one of the statements which they made, قالوا سمعنا فتى يذكرهم يقال له إبراهيم. You know who did this? This young man who always speak bad about these idols, his name is Ibrahim. For he used to speak in the open, he used to offend them. And Sheikh Adam recited في صلاة المغرب, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادًا يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ. Some people would take idols, would take rivals beside Allah, whom they love them exactly or as much as the love that they have for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They used to love their idols. The story is long, and I'm not going to stop at each detail here. I want to get to the area where Hajj is related. Ibrahim alayhi salam, at one stage, his people were leaving out of town for a certain feast somewhere. He decided to go and break all these idols, and he placed the tool with which he broke these idols with, the axe, on the shoulder of the al-kabir, the tallest or the big idol there. When they came back, they asked who did this. Like I said a minute ago, this guy, his name is Ibrahim, the fata, the young man. It tells you that he was a young man. He was not old. Some of the scholars actually said he was 16 years old when he did this. Bring him, they brought him. فَأْتُوا بِهِ عَلَىٰ أَعْيُنِ النَّاسِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَشْهَدُونَ. Did you do this to our idols? And here is Ibrahim alayhi salam. Did بَلْ فَعَلَهُ كَبِيرُهُمْ هَذَا فَاسْأَلُوهُمْ. This is the one who did it. Then right away they reflected upon the statement that we were worshipping idols which do not benefit nor harm us. But at the end of the day, they tried to get rid of him, burn him, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him from the fire. That is not the subject. He decided to migrate, to leave. He traveled from Iraq to Palestine. That is where he went. وَقَالَ إِنِّي مُهَاجِرٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّي. I am migrating for the sake of my Lord. And that tells you, ikhwa, that sometimes when your da'wah, if you're a caller to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and your da'wah is not working, is not producing, people are not listening. I mean, they try to burn you. Khalas, go somewhere else. You don't have to stay in a place where, you know, nobody is hearing you, nobody is listening. Subhanallah, he migrated to Palestine, and that's where he stayed. He married Sarah as well. In one of the accounts that she is a relative of his. At one stage, there was a drought in Palestine, in Palestine. Unlike the time of Yusuf, alayhi salam, later on, when there is a drought, people would go to Egypt. Why? Because Egypt has a running water. What river? The Nile runs there all the time. But normally these other places surrounding Egypt, they rely mainly on few rivers, but their reliance is based on is upon the rain and so forth. He took his wife and his nephew Lut alayhi salam to Egypt to bring some provision. We know لقد أعطي يوسف وأمه شطر جمال المخلوقات. You know how Yusuf alayhi salam was beautiful, Nabiullah Yusuf. In one of the wording that Yusuf alayhi salam was given half of the beauty of the creations, in one of the wording, and his mother, Yusuf and his mother. The scholars, they say his mother is Sarah, his grandmother. Sarah was an extremely beautiful woman. في صحيح البخاري حديث أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه that Egypt at the time was ruled by a man. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam described him to be Jabbar, oppressor. And he had a very interesting law. He's not only an oppressor, he's wicked too. He told his guards, the people who are guarding the borders of Egypt, that whenever you spot a beautiful female, a beautiful woman, you bring her to me, basically to rape her. Immediately, Nabiullah Ibrahim alayhi salam is traveling to Egypt. The guards spotted Sarah alayhi salam. We could say alayhi salam, but of course, she is not a prophet. We do not believe that women can be prophets, ikhwa, as a principle. They immediately reported the matter to the king. The king said, bring her to me. She arrived. Imagine, ikhwa, the situation of Ibrahim alayhi salam. This is the second tough situation he faces after the fire. Subhanallah, we went over this quickly because we want to get to the area of Hajj. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, يُبْعَثُ النَّاسُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ حُفَاتًا عُرَاتًا غُرْلًا. Mankind will be resurrected in the day of resurrection, hufa, barefoot, ura, naked, ghurlal, and circumcised. وأول من يكسى من الخلائق إبراهيم عليه السلام. And the first one who will be given a garment to wear, a cloth to wear, guess who? Who? Ibrahim. Why? Because before they throw him in the fire, they stripped him naked. They tore his clothes. They took his clothes off. And he stood out there, refusing to compromise. Compromise, la ilaha illallah. And he kept saying, Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil. Allah is all sufficient for me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who will take care of my affairs. The second tough situation that Ibrahim alayhi salam faced was when they came to take away his wife. Imagine you're in a foreign land and you have your wife with you and you're arriving and the policemen or the guards, they come and to take your wife away from you and you have nothing to do. Guess what he did? Like once it came to the fire, he said, Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil. Immediately he made wudu and he started making salah, yusalli, and making dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would save his wife. They took Sarah to the king. Sarah immediately made also this dua. Allahumma innaka ta'lam, O Allah, you know, anni qad amantu bika wa bi nabiyyik, that I have believed in you and in your prophet. Wa ahsantu farji illa ala zawji, and I'm a chaste woman. Farudda kayda hadha al-fajir, O Allah, protect me from this wicked man. The hadith says that his hand was paralyzed. In one of the wording, the hand of this oppressor before it landed or touched Sarah radiyallahu anha or alayha salam just turned into araq. He kept begging her, please invoke your God so that he would relieve me and I will let you go. She actually made dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would restore his hand back to him. And Allah accepted her dua. You're going to notice something very interesting about Hajj is the dua. The whole story is about dua. Ibrahim alayhi salam, to be saved from the fire, what did he say? Hada dua. Huh? Hasbi Allah wa ni'mal wakil, that's something that you say when you run out of what? Run out of your means, run out of your resources. There is no one out there to help you. Allah is all sufficient. And one of the wording of this hadith that Jibreel alayhi salam, can I help you? I said, no, you, not you. Hasbi Allahu, not even you. Hasbi Allahu wa ni'mal wakil. Dua, hada dua. Hada thana ala Allah. Is praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but a form of dua. Like the noon, like Nabiullah Yunus, when he was in the belly of the whale, what did he say? Huh? La ilaha illa anta subhanak. Hada thana ma'a dua. Yani you're praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with tawheed, but you're making dua. So here is Ibrahim alayhi salam, when they took away his wife, huh? What did he do? He started praying and making what? Dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would save his wife. And Sarah, when she was at on the spot and this king is about to rape her, she made this dua and Allah accepted her dua. Not only this, she actually asked Allah would relieve him, would release him, would restore his hand back, and Allah answered her dua. But subhanallah, because he's a wicked man, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala restored his hand back to him, yet he tried to attack her for the second time. He begged her two times. She made dua again, but the third time he fulfilled his promise and he called upon his guards and he said, take this evil woman away from here. خُذُوا هَذِي الشَّيْطَانَ. Sarah is the shaitana and he is the angel. Huh? Take this devilish woman away from here. And he given her a gift. Now this answers, where is Hajar? Because when we read the story of Hajj, the main character is who? Hajar. So where is Hajar? This is how Hajar entered into the family of Ibrahim. So this king given Sarah a maid, an Egyptian maid, whose name is who? Hagar or Hajar. Ibrahim, and he given them, given Ibrahim alayhi salam and his nephew Lut alayhi salam a lot of provision. Something that we should not forget, that Sarah alayhi salam was so excited that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved her. And that tells you how much she was concerned about her husband. She came back running to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Guess she found him doing what? Huh? He's still praying. He's still in salah, all of this. And he did not even want to interrupt his salah. He was so consumed with the salah that he did not break his salah or interrupt his salah to find out what happened. He finished his salah. But she told him while he was praying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spared your wife and protected her from the blood and the evil doing of this wicked oppressor. وَرَدَّ كَيْدَ الْفَاجِرِ فَإِبْرَاهِيمْ Hajar now, Sarah and Hajar and Lut traveled back from Egypt to Palestine again. Subhanallah, the story in is identical, and Abu Mujahid can testify to that in the book of Genesis. It's the same, yani almost, yani word by word. Now, at one stage, Ibrahim alayhi salam was longing to have a son. He's getting old, he's approaching the age of 60, and he is really wanting to have a son. Hajar, Sarah has been barren. She is not ready to have children. She can't have children because she is barren. Subhanallah, this is the top line of polygamy, as they call it. And I hope we don't have sisters here in the masjid tonight. Is it safe? Huh? Or I'm not inviting you to do anything, otherwise you're not going to come to the masjid at all, if they know that we talk about that. But this is the top line of polygamy. She said to him, I cannot have children. Why don't you marry my mate? And subhanAllah, that line is in the Genesis too. And I'm hinting to it because you find out that, you know, at one stage, the story in the book of Genesis or in the Old Testament dies. There is a cut that no longer there is a mention of Hajar. But in any rate, Ibrahim alayhi salam decided to take the advice of his wife and he married Hajar alayhi salam. And subhanallah, immediately she conceived. She bore for him a child. As soon as she delivered Ishmael, Sarah became jealous. And this is, by the way, the nature of men. And this is the nature of, the nature of women. That, you know, jealousy is something. Jealousy is the fitna. Al-ghira is the fitna of women, by the way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them with that jealousy. That, you know, sometimes you're nothing, you know, as a husband. I mean, not you, I mean, other people. I mean, but when you start looking at other females with her, you become what? She starts paying attention to you, and that's why sometimes the second marriage fixes the relation. And that's, I'm not saying that. That's beside the point here. But jealousy is, you know, the nature of, and that's where they get tested. Women are tested with this. You know, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislated that a man can marry 2, 3, and 4 if he is able and if he can do it. But Ibrahim alayhi salam, subhanallah, when he saw that Sarah was jealous, and he felt that the relationship is not going to work. And in another account, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to take Hajar and Ismail away. Ya ikhwa, it's very bad to present this as Sarah told Ibrahim to take Hajar and Ismail to the desert. Don't ever assume that. Sarah will never do this. Because this is a murder, that you're taking a child and his mom to the desert and leave them and come back. No, Ibrahim alayhi salam was commanded to do so. He took them where? To Mecca. And this is the site for Hajj. We're going to begin now entering into the area of Hajj. Ibrahim alayhi salam took Hajar, Ismail the baby, and little water, and some dates, and he arrived at the site in Mecca, and he's about to leave. Hajar asks Ibrahim alayhi salam this question: did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala command you to do so? She kept asking this question so many times. And at the end, Ibrahim alayhi salam with his head, awma, he hinted that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who commanded him to do so. And she made that beautiful statement again. And that shows you, ya ikhwa, subhanallah, if you reflect upon Hajar, she was living in the house of this oppressor almost all her life. And she came and spent a little time in the family of in the house of the family of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and how she learned faith, how she developed iman and faith and learned tawheed. And she makes that overwhelming statement: idhab, go, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never waste us, will never cause us basically to perish. He will take care of us, me and my baby. Ibrahim alayhi salam, in his way out, remember that was a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has nothing to do. Ibrahim alayhi salam was commanded to take Hajar and Ismail to Mecca for a wisdom, which we can see now. It coincided with the jealousy of Sarah, that there is another wife who has more significance and more importance in the life of Ibrahim alayhi salam, because she bore the child he was waiting for all his life for him. So Hajar immediately, she said, go, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never waste us. Remember the dua again. In his way out, like he did with Sarah, when she was taken by the wicked man, the oppressor, he made dua, he faced the Qibla, and he made that beautiful dua, which was mentioned in Surah Ibrahim alayhi salam. وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ اجْعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا. Oh Allah, make this place a place of security, a secure place, Mecca. وَجْنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ أَنْ نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ. And protect me and my offspring from the worship of idols. Here is, Rabbana, my Lord, inni askantu min durriyati. I have left a branch of my family, biwadin, near a valley, ghayra di zara, that doesn't have any water, inda baytika al-muharram, nearby your sacred house, your home. The house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Brothers, pay attention to something here. Who raised the foundation of the house? Who? Ibrahim and? Both. He made this dua when? Right after he placed Hajar and Ismail near what? in Mecca. So the house existed. So it's wrong to say Ibrahim is the one who built what? The Kaaba. I mean, he raised the walls. But initially, the Kaaba was there since Adam alayhi salam. ولذلك في آل عمران إن أول بيت indeed the first house وضع مبني المجهول the subject is not known وضع was placed for mankind للذي ببكة مباركة is the one in Mecca وهدى للعالمين. Now the scholars because the subject in the verse who built it initially is not there. They said the angels, they said Adam, a lot of assumption, and all of them can be correct. But in any rate, Ibrahim alayhi, the house of Allah during the flood of Nabiullah Nuh, well, there was a flood that flooded all of earth during the time of Nabiullah Nuh, and including the house in Mecca, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam to raise the foundation of the house and to clean it from the dirt and so forth. But the shahid is already the house existed. The house of Allah existed even at this time. رَبَّنَا إِنِّي أَسْكَنْتُ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي O Allah, I have placed a branch of my family بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ near a valley next to your sacred house. رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ O Allah, for them to establish the salah. فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهْوِي إِلَيْهِمْ O Allah, cause people to come to live with them. Look at the dua of Ibrahim, ya ikhwa. وَارْزُقْهُمْ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ And bestow upon them food from the vegetation of earth. So he made the dua and he left. Hajar and Ismail, imagine ya ikhwa, in the desert by themselves. They kept drinking the water and she's eating from the dates. Of course, we need to say that somehow the story dies miraculously in the book of Genesis. No longer there. How the story dies, that Sarah tells Ibrahim to take away Hajar and Ismail from here. And he took them somewhere. And they presented the whole thing because of jealousy. There is no longer, no mention anymore of the story. All of this comes from Hadith ibn Abbas fi Sahih al-Bukhari. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one who brought all of this to us. Hajar, she ran out of water, and the baby, of course, out of dates, now there is no milk, and the baby started weeping and crying. And imagine seeing your child crying, weeping out of hunger. This is the top of the line. She started seeking the means, running between those two mountains, Safa wal Marwa. ولذلك, subhanAllah, when you're performing Hajj, when you run between those two mountains, even to the extent that if you look at the rituals, that there is a portion, you're going to find it between two green lambs there, that you should run, you should jog if you're able to. Just to live the experience of who? Of Hajar. So when you're performing that sa'i between Safa and Marwa, you should reflect upon who? Huh? You see, that's what will give Hajj what? Life. You see, if we just walk between these two mountains, you're going to walk into, and you're, but why am I walking here? You know, what is this? No, you're supposed to recall that experience. And you don't have to reflect upon Hajar. I want you to imagine now the urgency or the condition of a mother running between two mountains in order to save her son, her child, from death. The sense of urgency here. So whatever you're going through, you know, you're running between those two mountains, you're walking between those two mountains, reflect upon yourself. Whatever you have in your life of urgency, Ya Rab, help me. I have my son who is not praying. Help me. And you keep making that dua. At the end, after seven rounds, Subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the relief. The hadith that I'm quoting right now in Bukhari, but in Mu'jam al-Tabarani, she saw Jibreel alayhi salam landing into earth. Jibreel alayhi salam touching the ground. And she approached him. And Jibreel alayhi salam asked her, "Who are you? Man anti?" Guess how she answered. She said, "Ana ummu waladi Ibrahim." I am the mother of Ibrahim's son. Shuf, how she presented herself. You know, because she knows Ibrahim has what? Has a status with Allah. Ibrahim, ya ikhwa, is Khalil al-Rahman. I don't know if we didn't even come across that. He's the friend of Allah. وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took Ibrahim for a friend. She knows the status of who Ibrahim is. If for sure you're sent by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you would know. Then Jibreel alayhi salam asked Hajar alayhi salam, وَلِمَنْ تَرَكَكُمَا. To whom did he leave you like this? شوف. قالت, she said, تَرَكَنَا إِلَى اللَّهِ. He left us for Allah. Allah will take care of us. Then Jibreel alayhi salam said to her, تَرَكَكُمَا إِلَى كَافٍ. He left you to the all-sufficient. He will take care of you. And he hit the earth with his wing, and then here is the well of what? Of Zamzam came out. Hajar, when she saw the water gushing out of the desert, she was so excited, she kept bordering, making like, you know, like a little circle around the water, and she kept saying to the water, what? Zoom, 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 in her language at the time. Enough, enough, that's enough water, enough water. Of course, we call it what? We call it what? Zam, zam. But she said what? Zoom, zoom, zam, zam. Stop, stop. But Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commented on this piece by saying, Rahim Allahu Hajar. May Allah have mercy on Hajar. If she would not have made that statement, Zamzam would have been what? A river running in the Arabia. But subhanAllah, in spite of being a whale, until this day, we go and we drink of it. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, مَا أُزَمْزَمْ لِمَا شُرِبَ لَهُ. الحديث صحيح يا إخوة. That whenever you drink Zamzam, before you drink, make an intention. You're drinking for something. This is not Zamzam. But before you drink, you make what? Like what? Ya Rab, memorize the Quran. Memorize Sahih al-Bukhari. Seriously, dawa is a healing. It can cure you. وابو ذر الغفاري ذا ستوري اوف هيز اسلام اف يو ريد هيز ستوري جندب بن جناده رضي الله عنه ذات هي سيد هي سبنت a long time in Mecca in order to meet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he had no food and the only nutrition I used to have was Zamzam. To the extent that I started developing, you know, these billy, I started having billy, can be so nutritious. Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah says that he would drink of it and he would see cure for certain diseases and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would cure him. But you can't be doing it with a testy kind of attitude. You know, and I think that's the issue that we have with a lot of Muslims. The lack of certainty. You can't be doubting these texts. You must be certain that whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said and whatever the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, it's true. It's true. And maybe I shared that story with you before, but a companion, the hadith fil Bukhari, came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, Ya Rasulallah, my messenger of Allah, I have a brother who's utliqa batnu, that his belly is what? He has diarrhea. This is a way to express it. His system is... And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the man, isqihi asala. Give him honey. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, يَخْرُجُ مِن بُطُونِهَا شَرَابٌ مُخْتَلِفٌ أَلْوَانُهُ فِيهِ شِفَاءٌ لِلنَّاسِ. Out of the bellies of the bees come out a drink mixed in colors, has what? Al-asal, honey is what? Cure. Al-asal al-nahl, the honey bees, not the black one, huh? Is what? Is cure. The nas Qur'ani, this is Qur'an. It doesn't say which disease. It doesn't say which disease. When Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Shifa ummati, the cure of my ummah in what? In three. Huh. What? Honey, two. Black seed, al-habba sawda, three. The branding. Wa akrahu lakum al-kay. But branding, I dislike it for my ummah. Al-huwa al-kay. It's disliked. The man said, okay. Branding is that you take hot metal and you brand yourself with it. So the man did so, but he didn't have what? That certainty. So he came back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the following day. Oh, Messenger of Allah, I given him honey, but he's still having what? It didn't do anything. As if he did it what? Look at the attitude. Oh. No, that's not how we deal with these issues. Look, the Prophet said what to him? Look, isqihi asala, the second day. Give him honey. Okay, he went back and he did. He came back, O Messenger of Allah, I given him honey and he's still having diarrhea. He said, isqihi asala, the third day. And then the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam really got a little bit, يعني, he said, صدق الله وكذب بطن أخيك. Look, that's how a certainty. Allah spoke the truth. What the truth? That honey has what? And the belly of your brother is lying. You see, that's the attitude when we deal with these texts. We must have certainty, yaqeen. You know what yaqeen is? Yaqeen is, there are three areas below yaqeen that you cannot have. One of them is called wahm. The second one is called شك. The third one is called ظن. You can't have those three. What is وهم? That you think the statement is not true, or the percentage of the truth of that statement is lower than the percentage of it's being untrue. The untrue is more than the true. That's the worst. Wahm. The second one is called what? Shak. That it's even. The true and untrue are what? That, you know what, maybe honey will do, maybe it will not. The third one, that the true percentage is higher than the untrue. But you still have a small percentage of doubt. Not even that. But yaqeen is what? This is what? True. The man went. The fourth day, he came back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, Ya Rasulallah, my brother is what? Is in good shape. Yaqeen. When you drink zamzam, and bifadlillah, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam made it one of the rituals of Hajj, that after you complete the tawaf, when you do tawaf al-umrah, you're supposed to go and do what? Drink from zamzam before you pray the two rak'ahs, in front of maqam Ibrahim alayhi salam. Subhanallah, here is the well of zamzam came out. Of course, when there is water in the desert, birds fly around it. At this time, there was a tribe, an Arabian tribe, called Jurhum. They were traveling in the desert looking for water. When they saw these birds circling around the well of Zamzam, they immediately traveled towards the destination. And this is the dua of who? Of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Waj'al af'idatan min an-nasi tahwi ilayhim. Of course, Hajar alayhi salam, they wanted to reside in the area with them near the Kaaba, near yani the house, which was not raised yet. But Hajar made it a condition that she is in charge of Zamzam. If you're going to stay here, I control the water. You drink for free, no problem, but this well is what is for us. Like I said, subhanallah, the story dies in the book of Genesis as if Ibrahim alayhi salam is so cruel. He took his wife and his son and he threw them in the desert and he left them just like that. But look, Hadith ibn Abbas tells us that Ibrahim alayhi salam made so many visits. We actually read four of them. As if he had always a round trip ticket, Mecca, Jerusalem, Mecca, with KLM Airlines, or KLM or what? What airline at the time? He was shuttling all the time, visiting his family. The first visit that we read in the Quran, when he was commanded to slay his son. Now we come to a controversy. Controversy. Is that right? Is that correct? The Jews and the Christians believe the sacrificed son is who? Ishaq. And we say it's who? But for us, does it make any difference? You see, that's the beauty of believing in all the messengers. For us, does it make any difference? Was it Ismail or Ishaq? Does it make any difference? No. Because لا نفرق, we don't place any distinction amongst the prophets and messengers of Allah. We love them all. And that's the beauty of Islam. That's what makes us so special. But I'm sorry, the text is crystal clear that it is Ismail. Even if you read their own literature, they made a mistake. And you're laughing. They made a mistake. Because in their literature, it says, Ibrahim was commanded, and here is how the command is worded. Take your only son and sacrifice him. The description only son would apply to who? To Ismail, because Ismail is the youngest. That means Ishaq was not what? Was not there yet. So they were supposed to take that word only out, but they forgot. But now when you confront them with this, they have a way to come out, by the way. Oh, Ismail was not a son. He came out of what? Subhanallah, out of wedlock, he tells the other. What do you mean out of wedlock? Ya Rajil, the top line of polygamy. I'm sorry, they didn't have the Supreme Court in Jerusalem at the time for Ibrahim alayhi salam to issue a marriage certificate for it to be a valid marriage. But this is the top line, that your first wife is telling you go and take another wife. Marry my mate, marry her. That's marriage. Ismail is a legitimate son. But mashallah, that's not our case, our issue. But our Quran tells us that the son is who? Is Ismail alayhi salam. Because look at the context in Surah As-Saffat. فَبَشَّرْنَاهُ بِغُلَامٍ حَلِيمٍ فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعَهُ السَّعِي. When he started walking, Ismail alayhi salam, قَالَ يَا بُنَيِّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ. And that tells you, يا إخوة, subhanAllah, يعني, a father like Ibrahim, who was willing to sacrifice himself for Allah, thrown in the fire, and a mother like Hajar, who tells her husband, go, Allah will never waste us. Allah will take care of us. Will produce who? Look. Imagine you taking your son now, who is 13, 14 years old. Sa'i, that he's at the age of walking. And you're telling him, my son, I saw a dream last night. Imagine that I'm supposed to slay you. Imagine what the reaction would be. Look, قَالَ يَا أَبَتِ فَعَلْ مَا تُؤْمَرْ. My father, do what you're commanded to do. Isn't that what his mother said earlier? Then go. Is this is a command from Allah? Then go. Allah will never waste us. Ya ikhwa, I'm telling you, one of the most difficult trials that a person can go through is the death of his own son or daughter. Imagine you're commanded to take the life of your own child. Why did Allah take Ibrahim for a friend? Because what? He never stopped. وَإِذِ ابْتَلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ رَبُّهُ بِكَلِمَاتٍ. Allah commanded Ibrahim certain commands, فَأَتَمَّهُنْ. He perfected the application of these commands. Allah is testifying in the Quran, وَإِبْرَاهِيمَ الَّذِي وَفَّى. Ibrahim, the one who fulfilled. That's why, subhanAllah, he's the uswa for all the prophets and messengers. We call him the father of the prophets. Even our messenger, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, was commanded to follow his footsteps. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمِ وَالَّذِي لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَ فِي إِبْرَاهِيمِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مَعَهُ. Here is somebody, a father, who's old, was given a son at an old age, was commanded through a dream, and this is a form of revelation, to slay the son, his own son. And he said, what? Sami'na, huh? Wa ata'na. Ma, this is the religion, ya ikhwan. What is the religion? The religion that you believe what you're told and you act upon what you're commanded. Hada wa ad-deen. Hada wa al-aqeedah. Hada al-iman. That Allah tells you certain things, akhbar, information, you believe it. Because the knower of the present and the future and the past is the one who is telling me this. And Allah commands you certain commands, you say, I hear and I obey. This is the religion. Oh, that you fulfill the commands and you believe with certainty what you're told. Look at the son. My son, do as you please. And we read, ya ikhwa, that when he wanted to slay his son, he placed him on his back. He said, no, my father put me on my face. ولذلك القرآن فلما أسلم وتله للجبين. Immediately when the knife was about to cut, it was a command, test, بلاء. فناديناه أي يا إبراهيم. O Ibrahim, you have fulfilled the command.
رأيتم قلبا أبويا يتقبل أمرا يأباه. أرأيتم ابنا يتلقى أمرا بالذبح ويرضاه ويجيب الابن بلا فزع افعل ما تؤمر أبتاه لن أعصي لإلهي أمرا من يعصي يوما مولاه واستل الوالد سكينا واستسلم ابن لرداه ألقاه برفق لجبين كي لا تتلقى عيناه وتهز الكون ضراعات ودعاء يقبله الله تتضرع للرب الأعلى أرض وسماء ومياه ويجيب الحق ورحمته سبقت في فضل عطاياه صدقت الرؤيا لا تحزن يا إبراهيم فديناه
قد صدقت الرؤيا إنا كذلك نجزي المحسنين. Look at this. إن هذا لهو البلاء المبين. And this was, in my opinion, the hardest of the tests. The fire was a test. His wife being taken by the oppressor was a test. Oh, this is the top of the line. Hajar, he was commanded to take his son and his wife to the desert and leave them there, was a test. This is the hardest. That you are to take your son to slay. But you see, that's what Islam is, that you submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A command from Allah, you fulfill it. ما تقف, don't stop. The problem with us now, we stop at the commands. We say, but well, I don't understand it. Maybe it's this, maybe it's that. Of course, we read, ya ikhwa, in الرمي الجمار, and this is when we come, just to show you all the rituals are linked to that story, that Ibrahim alayhi salam saw these dreams in the area of Mina. And Shaitan kept trying to distract him from fulfilling the command. And he would use pebbles to drive Shaitan away. He kept following him in these three places, Al-Jamar al-Kubra, Al-Wusta, and every time he would throw, that's why we also have that rituals of a. But you're not throwing the shaitan when you go there, huh? You're just, a lot of the hujjaj, unfortunately, they assume that they are actually throwing the pebbles at the shaitan. And sometimes they take their shoes off and they beat the shaitan up. Don't do that. Don't do that. It's not really the physical character of shaitan. It's a metaphor in a way. طيب. Subhanallah, look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rewarding you, your willingness to give up your own son to fulfill the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't only keep your son, but I'll give you what? Another son. And not only this, not from this wife, but from the other wife who sacrificed. Sarah sacrificed. You know, a wife telling her husband to go and marry another woman? I mean, this is one in a million. You find that. Look how Allah rewards her later on in the story. You're going to have فَبَشَّرْنَاهُ بِإِسْحَاقَ وَمِنْ وَرَاءِ إِسْحَاقَ يَعْقُوبُ. And that this by itself really refutes the notion that the sacrifice son is Ishaq, because the glad tiding for Ishaq came right after who? After Ismail being placed to the test with his father, being Ibrahim alayhi salam was commanded to sacrifice Ismail alayhi salam. So this is the first trip. The first trip. The second trip is a very interesting one. Ismail grown up to be a man, and he married to one of the women of Jurhum, of the Arabian tribe, Jurhum. And he used to work as a hunter. He used to hunt. So Ibrahim alayhi salam came to visit his son. He arrived, knock, knock, knock. Assalamu alaikum. The wife did not know who is he. An old man knocking, where is your husband? She said he went out to hunt, to bring provision for us. Then he asked her this question. كيف عيشكما? How is your life? How things are going? Look how the wife answered. Awful. Terrible. Not good. Miserable. Right away, Ibrahim alayhi salam said that this is ungrateful woman. This is not the ikhwa, the worst that you can have in your house, a woman who is ungrateful. Ooh, I want to say this is the reason why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to the women that you are the majority of the dwellers of hell. Hadith ibn Abbas fil Bukhari that the Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said ittala'tu ila ahli al-janna fawajadtu mu'dham ahliha min fuqara' al-muslimin wa ittala'tu ila ahli an-nar fawajadtu mu'dham ahliha min an-nisa'. I looked at Jannah and I found the majority of the dwellers of Jannah to be the poor of the Muslims. And I looked at hell and I found the majority of the dwellers in hell are women. One of the women, when they heard this hadith, walked behind the Prophet ﷺ and she asked him, why? Why are you saying this? He said, تَكْفُرْنَا الْعَشِيرِ. You are ungrateful to your husbands. وَتَكْفُرْنَا الْإِحْسَانِ لَوْ أَحْسَنَ إِلَيْكُنَّ الرَّجُلُ الدَّهْرَ كُلَّهِ. If your husband is going by the book, يعني, and he does something bad, then you what? مَا رَأَيْنَ مِنْكَ خَيْرًا قَطْ. You wipe away. Normally, a woman who is ungrateful, or the quality of ungratefulness is not good in general. Al insan, you know, a person likes to live with somebody who always says, Alhamdulillah, things are good, mashallah, things are doing great, Alhamdulillah. Yeah, we all have problems. Listen, nobody's free from problems. This life is a test. We're here to be tested. If you're not going through a test, then there is something wrong with you. I'm telling you, but a person should overcome these, you know, feelings, and always say what? Alhamdulillah, things are okay. Allah blesses you because of this. Saying Alhamdulillah and showing a good attitude towards life would normally the reason. ولذلك ابن القيم says, الحمد والشكر, being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. هو الحافظ والجالب, is the keeper and the bringer. The keeper of the little blessing, if you think it's little, what you have and what will bring you more. In any rate, Ibrahim alayhi salam left with a will. He told her, listen, when your husband comes back, convey my greetings to him and tell him to change atabata dari, the entry to his house, the doorstep. Of course, the women did not understand what he meant. When Ismail alayhi salam returned, he felt that there was somebody here in the house. And he asked her, she said, yes, an old man. And he said, change your doorstep. He said, this is my father, and he is commanding me to divorce you. Go home. This brings a big, big issue here, especially nowadays. Can the father commands his son to divorce his wife and it's okay? Huh? Because we do have another hadith in this area too, that Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, at one stage, he told his son Abdullah to divorce his wife. Abdullah ibn Umar, Sahabi. And Abdullah used to love his wife. فعمر said to his son, divorce her. Then Abdullah went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam complaining. O Messenger of Allah, my father is commanding me to divorce my wife. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said to Abdullah, Ya Abdullah, ati' abak. O Abdullah, obey your father. For those two incidents, for they brought this question to Imam Ahmad, if a father commands his son to divorce his wife, should he execute? Imam Ahmad answered in a very interesting way. You know what he said? If the father has the caliber of Ibrahim and Umar, the caliber, once it comes to iman and faith. Yani, we're not asking to be exactly like them, but a father who doesn't pray, a father who doesn't even know the religion, commanding the son to divorce his wife, certainly you don't have to obey. Umar is somebody who is, you know, we read the story of the Ba'i'at al-Laban, the woman who used to sell milk. The fact that he saw righteousness and piety in this woman, he rushed home and woke up his children and asked one of them to marry her. You know the story when he heard that conversation between the seller of the milk and the mother and the daughter, and one of you has to marry this girl. So he knows righteousness and piety. And, you know, having a wife who is not righteous and pious can, you know, mess up your lineage, mess up your offspring. So Umar wanted to make sure that his son is not going to have children from a wife who is not righteous and pious. That's why he's commanding him to do so. But the answer to the question, no. You don't have to. If your father is not a Muslim who is practicing, is not a knowledgeable person, and so forth. So this is the second visit. Two more and we're done. The third visit, he arrived also when Ismail was not in the house. Knock, knock, knock. The new wife now answered, who it is? Where is your husband? He went out hunting for us. And he asked her the same exact question. How is your livelihood? How things are going? Look how she answered this time. What did she say? Alhamdulillah. Everything is wonderful. Alhamdulillah. You see, that's the attitude of a believer. Someone who believes in al-Qadr, Qadrullah. That whatever you're going through is what? إنك لن تؤمن, you will never attain true faith unless you believe whatever has inflicted you was not to miss you, and whatever has missed you was not to inflict you. Imagine this. There is nothing you can do about it. What are you going to do? Alhamdulillah. Everything is wonderful. Everything is good. Alhamdulillah. Ibrahim alayhi salam wanted to be fair. He actually asked one extra question to make sure that he is not faking it. وَمَا طَعَامُكُمَا طيب, what do you eat? If everything is good, what do you eat? What kind of food do you have? قالت, she said, اللحم والماء. We eat meat and we drink water. Then he made this dua, اللهم بارك لهما في اللحم والماء. Oh Allah, bless their meat and their water. That's why in Mecca, when you go to Mecca, subhanAllah, something that you see all over the place. I have no idea. Meat. Look in the trash can, look in the street, meat. You just see meat. The amount of meat is out of this world in Mecca. The final trip that we read is the trip when he was commanded to raise the foundation of the Kaaba. He arrived, actually, Ibrahim alayhi salam, and he saw his son sitting down and fixing his arrows, preparing to go hunting. And he approached him and they given one another a hug. And he said to him, my son, Allah has commanded me a certain command. Will you help me? He said, sure, father. He commanded me to raise the foundations of his house right here. And this is where, وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَاعِيلُ. Imagine Ibrahim عليه السلام used to take the bricks from him, and he used to build the walls of the Kaaba. And this is the echo, one of the most, building a house for Allah in earth. Contributing to this or being part of this is one of the most pleasing experiences that you enjoy so much. وشوف الأجر. Look at the reward. من بنى لله مسجدا ولو كمفحص قطا بنى الله له بيتا في الجنة. What time is Asha? We're still good? Oh, we're at the edge here. Whoever builds a house for Allah, even if it is the size of a bird nest. Imagine a house for Allah, the size of a bird nest. Allah will build a house for him in Jannah. The scholars looked at this hadith and said, can you pray in a bird nest? Can you? You cannot pray in a bird nest. He said, whoever, this is how they really interpreted the text. They said, whoever contribute to the construction of a masjid, even as little as a bird nest, a brick, that you contribute, you don't have to build, but the contribution to the construction of a house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And look at the reward. A minute ago, we said that in the day of resurrection, the first one who will be clothed will be who? Why? Because he was stripped naked in this dunya for Allah. Look, when the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam ascended to the sixth heaven, he saw who's there? The sixth or the seventh? The seventh heaven. He saw who there? Ibrahim. He saw him where? Subhanallah. Look at his reward. Look at his reward. As we speak, he's sitting. You know, there is a house for Allah in the seventh heaven. Every single day, 70,000 angels go and perform Hajj. And they are entitled to once in a lifetime visa. You see, over here, you can go as many times as you want, but they can only once in a lifetime. And Ibrahim alayhi salam is sitting and placing his back to the walls of the house of Allah, because he built the house for Allah where? He is the foundation for a house of Allah in earth. Here is him and Ibrahim alayhi salam raising these walls of the Kaaba. And Rabbana taqabbal minna. And after the completion, they went around the Kaaba 7 rounds, counter the clock, and they're saying what? Oh Allah, accept from us. In spite of them doing the job in an excellent way, but yet they are saying, oh Allah, accept from us, and they are making this dua. As you go and performing tawaf around the Kaaba, you always have to say that, oh Allah, accept from us, especially tawaf al-ifada, the final tawaf, as you go around the Kaaba as well. With this, inshallah, yani this is in brief. You know that story of Hajj is with every little stop, you can have a whole lecture. But I decided to cite it in one setting. Maybe this is an invitation for you to go and reflect upon it. It's really a story of a family, a story of a house, the family of Ibrahim, the father, the husband, the son, Ismail, the mother, Hajar, Sarah is part of this story, and how they made Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, placed the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ahead of anything in their lives. The work for Allah, the service for Allah, serving the deen of Allah. And look how Allah blessed this family. That here I am sitting here thousands of years after their demise, and we're sharing their story. And sharing it from there. From where? From the Quran and the Sunnah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted us to know about this family. And as the season of Hajj approaches, before you go for Hajj in particular, go over that story. And the brothers and the sisters who are in here, not going for Hajj, you should look into the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam and reflect upon it. With this, inshallah, we stop, and hopefully I'll be here tomorrow night. Maybe you can answer questions. Did you take care of that? Not yet? Okay. So inshallah, we'll stop here, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Unless if you have any unspoken questions, silent questions. No questions? Inshallah, tafadhal.